What do you do if your child gets caught in a cycle of self-destructive or even dangerous behavior? Some desperate parents are having their children abducted, taken against their will to a behavior modification program.
The reality is torture of children.
I got here at 3 in the morning, and they said I was not allowed to talk anymore, and you can never leave.
They were being treated like prisoners.
I had never done drugs in my entire life, but in order for me to graduate, I had to confess to using heroin, crack, cocaine, LSD.
They dehumanize the kids, that these kids are liars and manipulators. They use that to create compliance.
It's hard to comply with something that you know is wrong.
We have these handwritten, signed and dated confessions of abuse.
Whoa! Oh my God! Oh my God!
They use physiological experiences to manipulate the mind.
It's meant to break you. Palms up, palms down.
It is literal brainwashing.
You are at fault. You are to blame.
Palms together, palms apart.
The people that the program most wants to influence is the parents. It was basically a cult.
And we're talking worldwide.
It's a billion-dollar industry.
It all went into this.
And it was just to make this guy rich.
It is human trafficking of children.
All these kids being robbed of normal childhoods.
It's all just still operating.
He walked out in the gray light and stood, and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold, relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. The blind dogs of the sun in their running. The crushing black vacuum of the universe. And somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it. And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Welcome to Death of the Universe, a podcast that will not rest until all of the Dr. Phil's and Tony Robbins's of the world are disemboweled and only remembered as cautionary tales. It is 10:32 a.m., March 30th, Korea Standard Time, Year of Our Lord 2024. Josh here, Tim there. Tim, how's the life of the Friday night treating you?
The Friday night bandit, that's what they call me. I'm doing good. I'm happy to once again be back on the only podcast that's willing to say Joseph Lieberman, more like Joseph Deadman.
Oh, that's good.
That's a good one, right? That's a good one. Fuck that guy, right? Real piece of shit. But yeah, Josh, doing pretty good. Hanging out. Yeah, tough couple of weeks, 50-hour work weeks back to back. Got one more ahead of me. So, we'll see if I make it out alive. Otherwise, doing pretty good.
Sorry, I was like, is there German language angle to the Lieberman, like leap? I couldn't remember what the word for life in German
Liebermensch
was. But yeah, like Liebe is love, so yeah. Lieber dear. or better, or preferably Joseph, preferably man.
Preferably, yeah, he did prefer man. Joseph got his ass.
Joseph, better man. Can't find a better man. Something there. There's something there. I mean, you already got there, but
I got straight to the point. His ass is roasting in hell with his best friend John McCain.
I kind of, if someone had told me that he had died 10 years ago, I would have believed it, though. I completely kind of forgot about that guy.
It's not that old, though. Really?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I just haven't seen him in, like, the public eye for a long time. And when I did see him, like, 20 years ago, he was a gray-haired man, which I consider old.
Yep. Nailed it. Got his ass. Oh, damn. I was going to, you know what I was going to do? I was going to compare his age to Mitch McConnell and be like, oh, yeah, you know, he's, you know, only 82. I looked up Mitch McConnell. Mitch McConnell also 82, exact same age. So,
Joe Biden, right? Isn't Joe Biden 82 yet? 81.
How old is J. Robinette B? How old is that? Our current president. 81. He's spry compared to those two fuckers.
Yes, 1 year spry. Spryer. Yes.
Well, I mean, you want to talk about real spry, we talk about Donald Trump at 77. Now that's
spring a young chicken. Buck.
We're not, again, this podcast, we just call balls and strikes right down the middle. This is not an endorsement of Donald Trump. Just saying he is younger than the rest of the people we're talking about. And younger still is Obama. They should make a rule where if you're like under 70, you can do an extra term as president. Because it's like, if you do it, you know, it's kind of like, you know, when you, like me, I like partied a lot when I was really young and did a lot of drugs and all this stuff. So I kind of partied out and like, you know, whatever, don't care as much about any of that stuff anymore now that I'm older. You know, it's kind of that, like, he did it when he was so young that, like, he probably didn't even really get to enjoy it as much as he could now as an older man. You know, obviously we've seen what an 80-year-old can do as president. Like, that's when you're really in the golden eras of being the new FDR.
Yeah, you're really in the pocket there.
yeah.
Also, German language update. Life is Leben in German. So okay. It's close. Joseph Leben, Lebenman, more like Deadman. Okay, got it.
Yes, got his ass.
Totenman. I think that's death in German. I'll stop.
I don't know who's Ashley Biden. Who is that? Is this Joe Biden's jet? I guess it's Joe Biden's daughter.
It's the unsung daughter. Only thing I know about her is like she also like was in and out of rehabs, but not quite to the extent as Hunty boy.
Yeah. The Huntsman.
The Huntsman.
They made that movie about him. Everyone saw that.
Yeah.
Damn, China dabbing all over us. G is only 70 years old. Again, young
spring man. Chickens.
Jesus Christ, Bill Clinton's only 77. Bill Clinton is 77 years old. He looks like a fucking desiccated corpse.
That's true. Jesus. People blame the veganism for that, but I think they're overlooking the desiccating effects of adrenochrome. I think that's withdrawal. The more likely culprit.
It's the withdrawal. It's like the thing where you take HRT and then eventually your body starts producing its own testosterone, right? That's what happened to him. He was on it because he had the real connection. He was a fucking junkie for the stuff. And then you take it away, and then it all snaps back even to worse than ever. Either way, this is not a politics podcast this week, Josh. What are we doing? Just admiring it and talking about people's ages. That's like it, like the extent. We're not talking about their policies or anything. But it's not, you know, we're not doing politics here.
No, not really. I mean, adjacently. Michelle Obama, today.
Michelle Obama, this picture with a bob is not doing her favors. I don't know why she looks weird with bangs. They shouldn't have. It's a weird picture. Either way.
Just as we pivot away from the politics gossip, we talk about Michelle Obama's bangs. It's how we roll here. Yeah, today's going to be a little bit of a purification rundown, as they call it in Scientology. Going to sweat it out. No, we're going to discuss a fairly new Netflix docuseries called The Program. What is the subtitle on that? Hans, Cults, and Kidnapping. I'm going off of memory on this.
That is, I don't think, correct. Yes, Cons, Cults, and Kidnapping, that's it.
Correct.
And they did, that's a tricky one, because it's alliteration, but it's one of the letters is different. You know, it's CCK, like the Calamari Catch Crew, who are reuniting this coming up weekend, WrestleMania weekend, they're wrestling,
I planned it out this way, because of course I know about that.
Of course.
I know about the thing you just said.
I didn't get to talk about wrestling this week, or not doing an episode of that podcast, so I got to talk to you about it. How do you feel about the Rock stuff? Do you think he's doing pretty good? I think the Rock is, I'm not liking it. I think he's stinky poo-poo. Anyways, I'm just messing around. Let's move on.
Here's how keyed into all that I am. He still wrestles.
He came back. So, okay. I'm not doing this. Let's move on. Moving on.
Could see
this was a joke. I'm not going to, because I will start explaining this stuff.
I can see the glimmer in your eye and exactly. Time to shut it down.
Yeah.
So yes, The Program, Cons, Cults, and Kidnapping. It's a three-part series about a particular institution that basically falls under this broad thing we could call the femme thing, not broad, wide-reaching thing that we could call, sometimes gets even shortened to TTI, the troubled teen industry, which is such a gross like phrase to behold in itself, like the idea of monetizing, I don't know. Trying to help, quote unquote, trying to help kids with mental issues of varying degrees or that don't exist at all. But getting into that more as we go along, a former inmate, we'll say student in quotation marks, of a cage one of these places, poster? Catherine Kubler. She's the one who, as she states in the documentary, says she's been working on this documentary for like a decade up like until that time, which is probably somewhat recently, I'm guessing. But yeah, she's basically investigating this institution, and then it branches out because she starts to realize that like these troubled teen industry style places are all over the country and outside of the country. And there's like actually a whole like vast network that's like all under like this wider umbrella corporation called the WASP, WWASP. But it kind of begins in the more micro level where it's like her and like people she's sort of stayed in contact with over the years who also stayed at the same place. The name of the place, I'm trying to find it here now, Academy at Ivy Ridge is the name of it. And it's been shut down since 2009. And so the documentary starts off with showing her and this like group of maybe like, I don't know, a dozen people who all stayed at this place at certain different times and varying lengths of time. They're just like digging through the detritus of this shuttered building, and the geniuses who run these places didn't think to maybe like get rid of the evidence of all of their horrendous abuses, which they like documented in great detail. So they're just like going through like this like gold mine of like evidence of like, because the whole point basically the way she describes it is it starts on a very personal level for her, where like she just wants to prove to her father who sent her to this fucking hellhole, like that everything she said about it was true, that like they really did, like,
yeah,
you know, that place was run weird, like a concentration camp, and kids were abused in various ways, and that there's like documentation to prove this fact. There's like people, right, handwritten, you know, you know, I tackled a kid for looking at me funny and then like slammed his head into a radiator, signed and dated, you know, like that kind of shit. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. No. I was interjecting. I should be the one apologizing, not you. But yeah, that part was weird, the way that it was like she was searching for proof for her dad, who seemed like already insanely supportive and actually like more like he was hoping for her to ever forgive him. You know what I mean? Like that was the dynamic. It felt like a lot more there. And but then like they like kind of had the counterpoint of the other girl who had like the drug test fucking note proof. And yeah, her parents were like, nah, fuck that. We don't believe you still. So I was just like, it's so weird to like, you know, and I'm naturally, we were talking about language earlier. I don't know if that was even on the podcast. Like, I want to say the word juxtapose because that has, like, people have taken to just using that word to mean, like, compare two things or like, you know, whatever. But that's not what the word actually means. But now everyone understands it to mean that. You know what I mean? But either way, like, to have that counterpoint, to have that balance to show, like, that she's trying, to, like you said, like, theoretically, the idea is they're digging through this shit to prove to her dad, but it seemed like her dad was like pretty much willing, like already willing to be like, yeah, I messed up and I'm sorry. And I just, you know, I wish that we could have a relationship and you like, we could be normal again. And like, not necessarily that he was looking for proof. And, you know, they did a pretty good job on this. I think it was very subtle of not like just throwing the stepmother under the bus, but it did kind of feel like it was probably the stepmother was the one who was the issue. With the whole thing. But yeah, that, and then the girl, but then, like I said, the counterpoint of the girl who's like, here's the proof that I didn't do drugs or whatever, and they're like, nah, you were a fuck up, whatever, fuck off.
Yeah, the girl who was literally just called a crack whore by the staff, like written on her name tags at seminars and shit. Yeah, there are a few like sort of like memorable like figures in this documentary, and she's one of them. I'd like to have all their names like in my mind, but I should just say maybe right now, like if anyone listening, if you're interested in this subject, maybe watch the documentary first and then come back, because you know it's over 3 hours long in total, so you know we're not going to be able to like perfectly summarize the whole thing. And I actually kind of like gave up on taking handwritten notes on my second watch of this, because at first I was just watching it because it was something that interested me. I wasn't planning on doing it for the podcast, but when I went back like yesterday and started watching it again and had like a notebook open, and I was like, if I do actually take notes on everything that's interesting to me, this is going to take me like 10 hours to get through. So I just,
that's kind of interesting to me. Number one, like, you know, get better at taking notes. So you said your handwriting, I would recommend typing them and use shorthand. Maybe take a stenographer course. You can do it online. Either way. But the thing that's actually interesting to me with that is like, I watched it, and yes, it was like a little bit ago, but like, I didn't really find a ton of it super interesting. And I do think it was very much like, you know, not like a ton of details that were interesting, but I did find that it kind of fell into the camp of like Netflixification of media, where like you said, this is 3 hours and three episodes, and it like really didn't need to be. It could have been probably an hour and a half to 2 hours, just one like one movie, and that was it. And I felt like it was really kind of stretched out in a way that was not necessary.
Maybe I don't know. I mean, maybe the difference between us might be that I worked at a place in the vein of these places. And so maybe, I don't know, it got me thinking about that more, but I don't know. I didn't feel like there was too much repetition or anything. And like, when I watched it a second time, I actually even noticed more things, like more, I don't know, interesting details to me. But I mean, and by interesting details, I mean, basically it's like the particular abuses and then the way that these institutions are structured, like in terms of like being like a franchise. Like once you get into the third episode, the third The third one may have been my favorite in a way, because it did start to really tackle, like, I mean, the third one is literally entitled Part Three, Follow the Money. And so it does dig into, like, who's funding these places. And surprise, surprise, it is just like this, like, giant group founded by, like, an absolute fucking cretin, like, just these shameless fucking pigs shoveling money into their giant mouths. Like, I guess we'll get to that a little later down the line. But I mean, yeah, I don't know. My overall, like, impression of the documentary, like, I think it's a fair criticism to say that, like, Netflix does tend to, like, stretch things out that don't necessarily need to be, including, like fictional stuff too. But, you know, I guess they do it with documentaries as well. But I don't know. Sometimes I think it's warranted. And did, I mean, you... I would have probably watched another couple of episodes on this topic, because they could have definitely branched out even further, because as far back as they do kind of, like, pull the lens on the whole thing, like, they're still only touching upon, like, a small percentage of this world that exists of monetizing troubled teens.
Well, I was going to ask, and, you know, maybe it plays into what you're just saying there about, like, you would have watched more of it. Did you watch that Hell Camp, Teen Hell Camp or whatever?
I just mentally put it on my list, like, right before we started recording. I hadn't really heard of it before, or if I had, I just forgot about it. But yeah, I'm curious about that too. That's the one that focuses on, like, the wilderness camp versions of this same thing, right?
Right. And that's the one, I think, that's produced or whatever by Paris Hilton, which I thought, I confused myself watching it, because, like, partway through this, because I didn't know when this came out, I was like, is this the Paris Hilton one that I had heard about? And, like, she paid this girl to, like, you know what I mean, to be, like, the face of it, but she was, like, a producer on it or something. I, like, you know, I wasn't sure. And then I, like, yeah, looked it up and figured it out, and I was like, okay, no, so as you said, like, there's more content in this vein, because that's kind of part of the weird thing about it too, is that, like, this is not the first time Netflix has done a series about this concept, this whole thing. So the idea that, like I said, like, there's more than enough. It's like, it is just, like, you know, I hate to say it, and maybe you appreciate it, but it's like, it's just content for the content mill. You know what I mean? It's just like, okay, let's make this out. It's got to be a series. We've got to, like, do all this so that, like, people just watch it, you know? And that's, like, all there really is to it.
Well, yeah, you're just describing, like, the like, basic mechanism of a streaming service. Sure, they want people to watch stuff, but I mean, I'm just saying that I don't know. I find the subject matter interesting, and that I think it was handled pretty well. I think this former student, again in quotes, like, did a pretty good job directing this doc, and that it is, I mean, it still is, like, it's like this whole sort of subculture, sub corporate world that not necessarily a lot of people know about. And if there's any good way to sort of, like, warn, like, middle to middle upper class parents who send their kids to these places, which is usually who it is, it might be to, like, get a, you know, a high profile Netflix documentary on it going, like, you know, the types of the dad of the girl who directed this thing, you know, he would have probably believed a Netflix documentary like this had he seen it, and maybe not sent his kid to a place like this. So I guess I'm saying there's some, like, social value in these kind of documentaries, even if it is maybe cynically employed by, you know, a soulless machine like Netflix or whatever. I don't know. I still found it to be, genuine, and, you know, until the end, and until a new documentary comes out that's like, it's bullshit. These kids just had an axe to grind against these wonderful institutions. I'm going to tend to believe what they were saying. And I'm not saying that you're not believing them or whatever, but I was so confused because there's like a couple of shots in the documentary of, I was like, is that Paris Hilton or is that someone who just looks like Paris Hilton? What the fuck's going on? Because I did not understand that she had any connection to this world. But yeah, I'm seeing now that she produced this other documentary and like opened up about her own like abuse within one of these programs, which I'm slightly surprised that someone like her would be sent away to one of these things. But then at the same time, I guess not. I don't know. I don't know exactly what her experience was. I mean, it sounds like it was pretty bad. Like the one thing I had overheard in some of my outside the documentary research was like she was subjected to like forcible gynecological exams is the way it was put, which is probably like the most polite way you could put something like that. Anyway, that got cleared up. But while I was watching the documentary, I was just confused. I was like, that sure looks like Paris Hilton in the back. I was confused because I was like, oh, well, if they have like access to her, like, why isn't she like a talking head like in this documentary? But, you know, maybe they didn't. I don't know. Maybe they didn't care about her like celebrity status as it is.
Well, after I realized that this was not like the same. It was not her documentary, right? And that it was like a separate thing. But it makes sense that they didn't have her as a talking head on it because, like, again, it would be like double dipping or whatever. And it's like repeating content that you already have. But it was good to have like just a couple clips of her as like a little teaser for people like you and me, I guess. But I'm not going to actually do it. Like, to be like, oh, you know, like we have other content about this topic as well with Paris Hilton. Go check that out. But it's like, if you just rehashed it on here, if there's people who have already seen the other one and then they're watching this, it's like, oh, I've already heard all these stories and seen all this stuff. You know what I mean? So it's like a nice little, it's kind of, you get both. You get like a promo for the other stuff and you get like a little, like a wink and a nod and whatever to it. But yeah, either way.
I guess maybe just try to sort of summarize the general way that these places work. Oftentimes, kids are, you know, to go into the subtitle here, kidnapped, but they euphemize it as a transported, or it's you hire out a transport service, which is like, you know, 400 pound fucking slob men with handcuffs break into a teenager's bedroom and scare the living shit out of them in the middle of the night. Like, you know, they are not forewarned about this. And this is all, you know, parents consenting to this shit. And, you know, it's always like, you know, middle of the night type thing. And they handcuff you. They don't explain what the fuck is happening really at all. Other than maybe they'll say, we're taking you to your new school. And like, from what I've been reading about this and what's described in the documentary, you've got, forget about time to pack, like, you're not allowed to even like to say anything to the parents. Sometimes the parents are like looking on, sometimes they're not. So, you know, even if you're like 16 or 17, like that's still gotta be, I mean, that would be fucked up no matter what age. But like when you realize that like your parents are like doing this to you, that's gonna be, let's say, nerve-wracking at the very least. And but then, yeah, they throw you into a car or, you know, depending, sometimes like get you on a flight and take you to this place where they tend to situate a lot of these houses, these institutes, quote unquote schools in rural areas that are pretty damn far away from like civilization, or, you know, the closest thing is maybe like a really small town. Which is how this particular place, Academy at Ivy Ridge, was set up. And I don't think that that's by accident. Obviously, kids would love to run away from these places, and it makes it basically impossible, as they point out in the documentary, because they're just surrounded by like miles and miles and miles of like dense forest. So then you arrive at these types of places, and a lot of the times, like, they'll basically sedate you with, like, I don't know, antipsychotic meds like Thorazine or Depakote. I know that was my personal experience at the place that I worked, which I'll say just like up top, the place I worked was not nearly as bad as the place in the documentary, but there were problems with it. And I know for sure that children were killed in quote unquote restraint maneuvers at the place that I worked. So I'm saying I'm also not trying to say it's one of the good ones, but I'm just, there are distinctions. So like one big distinction would be that at this place in the documentary and at many of the places like it, like a number one rule is no talking, period. And then beyond that, no like eye contact essentially with anybody, no smiling is one of the rules. And then the way that these places work, it's very much like a cult, in terms of so what, like in Scientology, there's like the bridge, right? Is that what it's called? Like the bridge to understanding or whatever the fuck it's called. I can't remember. But it's the point system and like the level system. And in Scientology, you basically just you move up the levels by like pay more and more money. You know, you are like doing other things, I guess, as well, but like it's mostly you're just buying your way up the ladder. That's like how Tom Cruise is at like OT 10,000 or whatever now. But here it's a very strict points based system. You arrive, you're at zero, and you know, for like it's very easy to lose points and it's very hard to gain points. And at this particular place, God, the names of these places are so generic. It's hard to remember them, but
They try to make them that way. So it's like really easy to just like switch names, move around, do all that stuff and like never get noticed, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Cause that, yeah. And that's what happens. Like these places get shut down and they pop up immediately with a new one with a slightly new, like, cheesy as fuck generic name, like hidden ranch creek, you know, shit like that. Shining time station, yeah, that's one.
Yeah, I remember that one. The Ringo Starr is there.
the rules are just so draconian and insane, like smiling, talking. Like the place I worked, it was not like that, you know. And you know, they would, you know, encourage socializing amongst like the inmates, aka students. What were some of the other wild rules? Oh, like any going to the bathroom, you had zero privacy. You just had to have like the stall door open and some staff member just like leering at you while you take a shit. I think they said looking at the mirror was an offense.
Yeah.
Looking out the window, it's like you got windows everywhere. People are gonna like naturally look. So like you're like physical being is like being scrutinized so heavily, and it's by people that a lot of the times are just totally unqualified for any sort of job where they should be like trying to enrich the mental health of anyone, let alone people in like this developmental stage like that you're in when you're a teenager. And that was something more I could like identify with firsthand, was like the people I worked with and myself included. I shouldn't have really had that job. I mean, I was like probably one of the better people at it because like I wasn't a fucking asshole piece of shit to the kids that I worked with. But like all the guys I worked with were just these like just total meathead morons, for lack of a better word. And who you could tell, let's say, didn't not enjoy tackling kids to the ground and pinning them down, you know, for quote unquote for their safety, you know, is how it's always like phrased. But and other things at these places, like they almost all have like these solitary confinement rooms that are just like these bare tiny little closets essentially. And there's like these horror stories of kids like staying in these things for literally like months at a time. I guess on that topic, I'll say, you know, check the show description. I'll drop these in there, but there's like, it's a pretty good website that like kind of collects a lot of these like testimonials and gives like some pretty good overviews of these places. And one is called waspsurvivors.com, and that's WASP with two W's, which is the acronym of that evil umbrella corporation that runs a lot of these places. And then the other one was unsilenced.org, and that has a bunch of other good resources about this stuff if you're interested, including like an actual timeline of like where this all kind of started, this whole kind of these private boarding school behavioral reconditioning type schools. And the earliest one they have on the timeline here is called the Devereux Foundation, which I guess still exists to some degree and is like a, you know, multi-million-dollar quote unquote nonprofit organization. I mean, of course, this is another thing that we find out in this documentary is that these places are just making absolute bank. And yeah, some of the kids in the documentary, when they're like, you know, going through all these files that just were left behind at this abandoned building, they're finding out like how much money their parents had actually spent and how much money people were spending in general. And it's, you know, it's shockingly high considering like what people were receiving in exchange for this money, which was basically, I think the director, she says, "Oh, my dad paid 70 grand for me to get PTSD over the course of like a little over a year." So it's not cheap, say. Yeah, I'm sure I'm leaving out some of it. Oh, the other thing is like the kids have to just like anytime they walk somewhere, they have to walk in this ridiculous, like sort of pseudo military style where they're what do you call that? And you like kind of like do like a sharp like pivot on your heels when you like turn a corner, like that kind of shit. And it's all just designed to like basically break people down, very much in the style of like that cults use to brainwash people. Because almost every single one of these kids talks about like going through the same sort of like journey of just like disbelief, like hating this place, kind of, you know, not really playing into the program, but then just getting broken down eventually to the point where it's like, okay, all I can do is like try to play this game, this weird points-based game that they've put me on. And yeah, some of the, like the language in it as well, like where they like the staff would like positively use the term like breakdown, like, oh, who's going to be the one to break down so-and-so, like the most obstinate teen. And that was another one of the girls they interviewed who I guess never got off of level one. And at this particular place, there were six levels, and like levels 1 through 3 are considered lower, and levels 3, 4 through 6 are considered higher. And like they described like the difference between going from lower to higher level is like night and day. But and not that like, oh, they're actually being treated with like actual dignity in the higher level, but that like just the relative difference is so great that it creates this bizarre hierarchy thing where like you'll kind of do anything not to fall back down to the lower level. And then one of the more fucked up things is like once you reach this sort of higher level, part of what you have to do is basically do the job of the staff for them, and they basically mandate you to discipline other kids and to physically restrain other kids, which like, you know, at the place I worked, like that would have been like that would have been insane. But I don't know, who knows like what goes on behind closed doors as well. I can only speak to my like pretty limited experience, I guess. But I don't know, I saw some pretty fucked up stuff at my job though too. I remember there was one night. That was the other thing too, is they would, at least at my job, I think it was like every other weekend, they would put people on these like crazy long shifts where like you were even doing like overnight shifts on top of working all day. So like I would work like an entire Saturday and then have to stay awake all night, like just sort of like monitoring or whatever. But anyway, it was one of those nights, and it was like me and another staff guy in the cottage, as we called it, the small building that we were in. And I don't remember the details too well. Now, this was a while ago, but basically a kid was just kind of like throwing a tantrum, not wanting to be there. And it was just so wild, like, because the staff member that ended up basically beating the shit out of this kid in front of me, he was normally like pretty mild mannered and like one of the guys I actually liked compared to like the other like kind of like meathead dipshit dumbass guys that I worked with. But he just, I guess, like lost it. I just remember him like kicking off his Crocs or whatever, and just like squaring up against like this kid who was, you know, I mean, 18, but whatever, he still is like basically the mind of a child. And anyway, the fucking place that I worked with ended up being like covered in blood, like actually like blood was everywhere, like on the phone that I had to pick up to call 911. And so yeah, that was pretty wild. And yeah, I mean, like no consequences at all, like the entire like I mean, all the cops in the small town that we were located in showed up at this place, but like their only concern was like, where's this rascally kid? Where's he run off to? Not like, how did he like get his nose broken, etc.
Yeah, right. They're just looking for the money, looking for the property. They don't care about the damage done, which is fucking sad.
Yeah, you saying property just reminded me too of like how much the place I worked was also different from the places that were in this documentary, in the sense that the place I worked, it wasn't like middle to upper middle class white kids. It was like kids from the projects in Chicago who would basically, they would catch like some kind of misdemeanor usually. And then the judge would basically like, you know, part of their sentence would be like, you're going to go to this home for troubled kids up in the suburbs, and it's going to be on like the state's dime. Like, so in that sense, the place I worked was a little different in that way, but like still the people within this supposed nonprofit, the people at the top were like way too overcompensated and like wearing like fancy suits and shit. I remember the guy who hired me, like he was just, he reminded me of like a Steve Harvey type, down to like the fucking garish suits. And he was just, I don't know, there was just so much weirdness in that industry. And again, I worked at probably one of the lesser problematic type places like this, but you know, I could just see how ineffective it was firsthand, that was for sure. Like, and then yeah, like we had a fucking isolation chamber as well, and so many times, and you know, we just call it the box, like, oh, fucking Tyrone's in the box again, like losing his shit. Anyway, I feel like totally lost the plot on the documentary here.
That's fine. Yeah, the solitary, right? Like that's the big thing. That's like the big punishments in general. And it just speaks to like the social nature of humans, right? Which is crazy. It's like the number one punishment that you can make for humans is to just have them be separated from any other interaction with other people. It speaks to like the concept of Christianity, right? Where like hell is separation from Christ or whatever. Or
yeah.
Yeah, I guess when you're like Christian, right? It's like there is this natural instinct that we have in humans to understand like needing that connection to another, and you know, Jesus, God, whatever. Like in Christianity, it's like Jesus is like the number one coolest dude, right? And it's like, damn, could you imagine if you weren't able to ever hang out with the coolest dude ever again? Could you imagine being stuck in a room and the coolest guy who's ever existed, you can just never talk to him or see him or anything? And that's like the worst possible punishment. But yeah, it's pretty fucked up when you really think about the reason why that's like the worst punishment in, you know, in religion, in Christianity or whatever, is because of how much people crave connection. And we just do that shit offhandedly to children for no fucking reason. Like, really, no reason they're doing that to them. And they're spending, in the documentary, they're talking about people spending days. I mean, it's got to be exaggerated, but who fucking knows? When they're talking about people spending months in solitary, that's insane, right? That's not possible.
Yeah, I mean, we know it happens for sure in, like, you know, regular prisons. I was listening to one, like, sort of testimony, and it was someone who said that they had been in the hole or the box for actual months on end, and this person started developing, like, actual psychosis, like hearing voices type stuff, and the staff was, like, blaming them for it. Like, well, it's your bad behavior, and, like, you're hearing voices because, you know, you drink a Mike's Hard Lemonade. That's what got you in here. And I say that specifically because that's what happened to the director of this documentary. Like, that was the offense that got her thrown into this, like, horrible place, was because she was sent to, like, a religious boarding school, and they had, like, a no tolerance policy, and they caught her with a Mike's Hard Lemonade, and like, all right, now you get kidnapped and can go to this absolute hellhole, where, again, like, the thing of, like, I think at one point these people who had been former students there said that they thought maybe the worst part about all of it was the way that they were punished, like, not just discouraged, but, like, punished for forming any sort of relationships with the other kids. And and then they were showing, like, even, like, on the documents, it was like Catherine leaned on, you know, Kelly or whatever the fuck her name was. It was like stuff like that. It was like someone winked at someone. Someone smiled at someone. And it's like, that's a correction. And that was another thing about, like, these that, again, that a parallel with cults is, like, repurposing language so much, where, like, you create, like, a whole new, like, lingo and jargon for everything. Like, one of them, they were, like, using the word consequence, like, as, like, a verb, like, you're going to get consequenced or, like, I don't know. I just, there's something I really have always hated about that kind of speak. Although it also does remind me of, like, one of the funniest Upright Citizens Brigade sketches where they're clearly just, like, they're making fun of Scientology in the sketch, and it's like shit. It's like someone reading from, like, a Dianetics style book.
You're ready for level 9, buddy. And that means reading to you from L. Roy Stubborn's classic science fiction novel, Battle Zone Planet. For 3 human days, Johnny had been on the scary side of the moon, where the danger aliens were known to roam. He opened his space backpack to do an inventory. 1 sleep blanket, a flask holder of liquid drink water, 4 holder containers of nutrition food. Now, Josh, are you left-handed or right-handed?
I'm left-handed.
Through his vision glasses, Johnny saw a colony of danger aliens and feared they might catch the scent of his nutrition food. Josh, are you left-handed or right-handed?
Left-handed.
The danger aliens were out on patrol, hunting for nutrition food. Josh!
Left-handed!
Johnny thought with his mind brain, must bury the nutrition food. I must bury the nutrition food.
I'm right-handed! Just stop with the freaking nutrition food!
Awesome, buddy. You're right-handed, and I want you to do me a favor. I want you to write with your new right-handedness the word genius. Because you know what? Like, you're a right-handed genius.
He thought with his mind brain, I need the nutrition food. Like, all of that kind of shit. Or you just, like, double up words together to make it sound like it's more clinical or technical or something, but you just sound fucking stupid. But anyway, there's so much fucked up stuff in this. I mean, I guess maybe moving on to sort of the part 2 of the documentary, which is where they get into the what they call the seminars, which were a big part of what they do at these places, where they basically just, like, get these kids into a room for, like, all day or all weekend or something, and, like, have them go through these various, like, exercises that, like, are so obviously designed to kind of, like, break people down. And again, much like Scientology, they're trying to get people to admit to things whether they're true or not, that can kind of be used like to as leverage against them. But then they do even like even worse than that. Some of the examples were like getting kids to like blame their like Catherine, the director of the documentary, her mother died when she was like 2 years old. And in one of these seminars, she describes how so one of the things they do to like if you get people like physically exhausted, they're more like sort of open to suggestion or coercion. So one of the things they do it with these kids is they wrap towels in duct tape and then you have the kids like beat the ground with these duct taped towels and just like scream and like, you know, kind of like, and on the surface level, it's like, oh, well, maybe they're really, this is like primal scream therapy. They're like helping them get their frustrations out. But, you know, I mean, that's not the designed effect of this, because then they're also telling them, yeah, scream at your mom for dying of cancer and how she fucked up your life by dying of cancer. And then with this other girl, this poor other girl, I can't remember her name off the top of my head, but they said to her that that it was her fault that her father died in a car accident. And they were like, admit it. And like in the documentary, it shows her like sort of confessional journal thing that she writes in all caps, like, you know, I killed my dad. And the way what had really happened was she was a tiny little kid who had this like extremely traumatic event happen to her where they got in a horrific car accident and she watched her father die like right before her eyes. And then these fucking demons in this program are telling her it's your fault. And then they literally labeled her the mistake, like literally labeled, meaning like they took a name tag and put the mistake on it and made her wear it. And that's like all that anyone would refer to her as from there on out. And she said also at the beginning of this being of part two, they're playing, you know, the 2001 opening music. What is it? Also Sprach Zarathustra. You know, the one where the apes, yeah, and the monolith. Yeah.
It's the Ric Flair. It's Ric Flair's theme song.
The Ric Flair theme song. She said that they used that kind of music a lot. And would like there was like this weird use of music at these things. And then the other thing was, is they would like, they would do like these quick kind of humiliation rituals. So like with the boys, they would force them to like dress up in drag and like sing like I'm too sexy and shit like that, which I don't know how that's supposed to be therapeutic for them in any way. But then I mean, I guess this leads us into sort of the background of like where a lot of this stuff comes from. And so like Synanon, which was actually an outgrowth of AA. Synanon is basically, it's like, you know, it's just referred to as a cult now, like in retrospect. But what Synanon did, like kind of laid the groundwork for all the stuff that still exists today and that's, you know, described in the documentary.
The troubled teen industry began with Synanon, which was a cult that started in Santa Monica in 1958 by Charles E. Diedrich.
He got involved with Alcoholics Anonymous and he thought that AA was not tough enough, that what we should do is take the principles and the steps and impose them on people.
He created a residential treatment community of heroin addicts in which he pioneered harsh behavior modification tactics known as attack therapy.
You would basically find somebody's weak points, zero in on them, and attack them.
How many fights you had? You had none! You had none!
This could go on for 24 hours, even longer, and people would just wail on people till they'd be completely broken. The more anxious you become, the less clear your thinking is, and you become vulnerable to being influenced by the leaders into adopting their ideology.
Once Synanon was disbanded, its members went on to create other programs modeled after Synanon, but serving troubled teenagers.
These teenagers are the raw material of a growing industry that treats troubled kids.
Nancy Reagan popularized these programs with her Just Say No campaign in the War on Drugs.
There's nothing as awful for a parent as having something happen to their child.
She even brought Princess Diana to a program in one of her U.S. visits.
In the 80s and 90s, parents were told tough love was the only way to go.
And one of their big contributions to this horrible, horrible world of quote therapy is something they called attack therapy. I think in synonym terms, it was called like the game.
Yeah.
Basically what that is like they get someone to like confess their like deepest, darkest, whatever, like could be like abuse that they've suffered or like bad, you know, things they feel guilty about. And then basically an entire room of people just start screaming the most intense, like hateful, mean-spirited things at them, and this is supposed to somehow help them. And they show some examples of this in the documentary. Like it's kind of like a video montage. But
I'm really disgusted with you. You're really selfish and arrogant. That's how I feel about you. I love you.
I love you, Mom.
Humiliation and emotional attacks put people off balance, and they use that to create compliance.
If you break one of the rules or your attitude isn't right, you get yelled at.
You know, you don't even have enough self-esteem, okay?
They're tearing apart your self-esteem and tearing apart your trust in yourself and eventually tearing apart yourself.
Everybody went around and told you in so many words they think you suck as a person and that if they had their way, they'd cut your throat and relieve the human race of having to deal with an ingrate like you.
You could do a chart and trace the influence throughout the troubled teen industry. Every program is based on Synanon or based on something that was based on Synanon.
Yeah, it's all very bizarre. And apparently there's still groups using attack therapy. And this particular school that's like, you know, kind of the main focus, at least in the beginning of this documentary, they essentially did the same thing. One of the things they describe in the documentary is how they would just call people like victims, but like, you know, in a derogatory way, like, oh, you're just playing the victim. Like, you know, it's like someone could describe something where they are undeniably the victim of something. Like, you know, I don't know, let's say be raped as a child. And then this whole room of people, what they said they would do is like, so even to non-verbally basically like belittle people, they would put up like a V with their fingers, you know, like to their head, kind of in the way that like in the 90s people would do, like, you're a loser, and make like the loser L on the forehead.
They were doing the kawaii pose. I kept seeing it. It's the kawaii.
The angle's a little different, but
you get what I'm saying.
Yeah. It would be cute if it was like some K-pop, J-pop fan doing it, but it's pretty gross when it's these people in these therapy sessions going. And there's a part in the documentary where they're actually like they're sitting around in a sort of therapy circle. This is in like the abandoned building, like in like, you know, present day. And but they do like kind of a parody version of what a typical session would look like.
After I shared, I'm like, well, I had a really like hard time this week. I was just transported by two strangers who kidnapped me and brought me here to this place. I don't know where I am. I can't talk to my sisters. I don't know where my dad, like, what is happening? What is this place? How long am I going to be here? Blah, 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 blah. And then I would get feedback. Who wants to give me feedback based on my share? Alexa.
Catherine, are you open for feedback?
Yes.
Catherine, my experience of you is that you're acting like a victim. My encouragement for you is to do some deep soul searching, because clearly, again, you are doing some very non-working behavior. You're not going to be able to go home, and your parents aren't going to want you home until you start owning your greatness and get out of your image.
Great jargon. This was...
Yeah, it's just like the way that they can like rattle off the jargon still like 10, 15 years after the fact, or maybe 20 years after the fact, I think. Yeah, is kind of... Well, impressive is not really the right word, but it just shows how much this stuff like stuck with these kids. And that's the other fucked up thing is they would lie. You brought this up earlier, but like one girl in particular, and I'm sure this was not only in her case, but so like one of the first things they do when you arrive at these places is like give you a drug test and a pregnancy test. And they said, quote, your drug test lit up like a Christmas tree. Was just that sounds like the type of thing they just said to everyone, you know. And this girl, you know, she has nothing to gain from lying about it now, especially. Was like, I seriously never used drugs in my life at that point. And but they told my parents that I'd done every single drug on earth, and basically it gaslights you into confessing to making up shit that you never did. One of the talking head like experts, there's one woman who wrote a book about this stuff that I kind of want to read the book. It looked pretty interesting, but she was talking about like kids will just like, just teenagers are so susceptible to this kind of thing where they think like if to get like sort of the approval of authority figures and to like, you know, to eventually get out of this place, which is the main like kind of carrot they hold over everyone in these places, is like, if you ever want to leave here, you have to graduate the program. You got to work your program. And the only way to work your program is to basically fall into this in line with these fucking lies that people are telling you, like, no, you did drugs, you sucked dick for crack. And like, and it spirals out to like the examples that this one expert cited was like hearing kids say that they like fucked dogs to like get drugs and like would inject like heroin into their eyeballs. And like, it just sounds like, you know, it sounds like shit that like teenagers would make up to try to like push things to more and more extreme to like show that they're really working their program because they want to get the fuck out of this, you know, hellhole. So, yeah. And the other thing was at these seminars, if you basically refuse to kind of go along with the flow of like, you know, hitting, you know, slamming a duct taped towel on the floor and screaming about how you killed your dad because your dad got in a car accident, etc., you get kicked out of it. And again, here's the kind of like stupid like lingo speak they would use. They would say that you chose out of seminar, and then they would send you to a new seminar called Breakpoint.
Yeah,
very creative title. And the reason it's called Breakpoint is because it's meant to break you. And two of the girls...
Would you say that the point is that you break? Yeah.
I would. Yes, I would. So the two girls, they demonstrated what they had to do for 8 hours without any break. I mean, that's how they described it, which was this thing where they would just... They would say palms up, palms down, palms together, palms apart, and just move their hands in that direction and just do that. And in the documentary, they do it for like 30 seconds, and it's like it makes you feel insane just watching it. And then they said, yeah, and then you do that for until you dissociate, you like leave your body, and yeah, they just make you do that for 8 hours.
Okay. Throw a chair.
I literally, I am feeling a certain way in my body.
And that was only a minute?
Was that only a minute?
But how long did you do it for?
About 8 hours.
At least, uninterrupted.
Yeah.
So again, very, I'm sure a lot of therapeutic value in that. Not totally unhinged punishments for no reason. Oh yeah, that was the word for what I was trying to describe earlier, where like they like sort of physically exhaust you. I guess it's called like high arousal techniques.
Yeah.
And then they basically once the kids got to like the upper level 4 is when they would start to like basically truly brainwash the parents and like basically force the parents to do these weird seminars, which would just like get the parents even more committed to like against all reason and logic keep their kids in a place like this. And it almost goes without saying, I guess, but it, I guess it should be said that you're completely cut off from like the outside world in these places, and like you can eventually like earn your way up to like a heavily monitored like 15-minute phone call with your parents. But like the second you say anything sort of negative about the program, they just cut you off and like will tell the parents like, oh, your kid is just trying to manipulate you. You know, it's not true what they're saying, etc. Same goes with like letter writing. Like, you know, you couldn't like get a letter sent unless, you know, everything was like had to be pre-approved. And I think they eventually, when you were like higher up level, you could have like an unsupervised visit with your parent for a few hours. But they would like, again, just sort of like warn the parents about like, you know, basically if you hear, if your kid says they want to leave, it's just because, you know, they're being bad and they're trying to manipulate you and they're not working their program and jargon. And they do go into in the documentary too how the parents are manipulated. I mean, I have less sympathy for the parents than I do for the kids, I would guess, obviously, in a way, like, but. It appears that the parents really don't know what's going on in these places. And then I guess the sad part is like, even when the kids can manage to tell them like, hey, they don't let us like speak here or look out the window, you know, or whatever, or like even, or even worse, you know, more concretely worse stuff like being sexually abused and, you know, strip searched and all that. Oh, that was another one. Part of the intake was like people being strip searched and told to squat and cough and all that because they're looking for what, cell phones in orifices?
They were looking for holes. They were looking to look inside some holes.
Yeah. You know, there was a weird thing where like the one of the sort of like main girls who was there, she describes like very tearfully in front of like those friends, like her being molested by a female staff. And I think they say in the like the VO, like the director's like, we couldn't reveal the name of this person, you know, for like some like ongoing legal reasons or something like that.
Right. We found multiple eyewitness statements that are signed and dated detailing the incident with Diana at Sis's desk. And hundreds of other abusive incidents that took place at Ivy Ridge. But unfortunately, there was some abuse that was never documented. Multiple girls have come forward to tell me about sexual abuse by a staff member. Other staff members corroborated this as well. It seems to have been an open secret at Ivy Ridge. But since no reports were ever filed, I'm not allowed to name them.
But then do you remember the part like kind of early on? And I think in the first part where they run into like the former staff member at the diner.
Yes.
And then interview her.
Yeah.
I thought that part was so weird because that lady was like awful, like when she worked there, but she like, she still was like, I was surprised she wanted to like sit down and do an interview, which made me think that like she really doesn't think she really did anything wrong. But
sure.
I felt like it was weirdly implied that she's the one who was doing the molesting because they kept saying like how they're like all the girls were like, oh, she loved strip searches like more than anybody. And she was like always gung ho about strip searching. And then. Right. When they're in the diner, like doing the interview part, they get interrupted right as the former staff lady is saying something to the effect of like, you know, who I felt especially bad for. And she kind of like looks around nervously and goes like the gay girls. And then they get interrupted by the producer of the documentary saying that they need to leave the diner because one of the waitresses didn't want them there. Talking about, you know, talking shit about this place that's not even open anymore. I don't know. That whole thing was kind of weird. But anyway, that was just my sort of my theory upon the second viewing that maybe they're kind of implying that that's who was up to no good in that sense. But
sure, in any case, sure. Yeah.
I mean, they also described that woman as like sitting on the chest of another girl and force feeding her fucking antipsychotic meds, like upon her entrance into the place, which is, you know, very cool. Nothing wrong with that.
The medication, I think, is the big one. They were making me like zombified. I don't feel good. And I was like, I'm not taking these meds. And I just remember sitting behind Sissy's desk.
they're like, you're gonna take your meds, you're gonna take your meds. And sis got out of her chair and stood over me. She pushed me to the ground and then sat down on my chest, well over 100 pounds heavier than me. And she was like smiling like crazy. Like she like loves, she's like, ah. She's like, I'm gonna break Dinah, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna hurt, like, I'm gonna be the one who gets these meds into her. So they held my nose like this and then had their hand over my mouth. So either they're going like this or they're going like this. And so it was literally like I was grabbing for anything I could. Like I couldn't breathe. I was like going like this. And then I started blacking out. So I was going in and out of consciousness. So they got the pills in somehow and I took them. I fought for a pretty long time. But if I had continued to because I was blacking out, I'm assuming I would have not been here today.
Yeah, I don't know. There's like, yeah, like, I mean, so like I said, there's just like a lot of obvious parallels to like cults. There's usually a lot of like a lot of these places tend to be like, if not explicitly religious, like it's implicitly religious minded. So I guess we could maybe talk sure. about like the people, the sort of people at the top, that we discover in the third oh, final yeah. part.
Yeah. The last one, they really get into it and they especially like, they name names and they do a pretty good job of just hitting the horn. And it's really interesting because as you said, like throughout it, they work like kind of sensitive or careful with like, we don't want to get sued. But then in the last episode, they're just like, fuck it. And they're like, these people, this name, these families, they're fucking pricks. All of them suck. These people are making a bunch of money. That was like crazy to me because I was like, damn, they must really have these guys dead to rights to just call it out like that.
Well, I mean, a lot of that stuff is just matter of public record, right? They're limited liability corporations. So like they're not even really trying to hide themselves that much because they're so protected in a legal sense from any liability because they have like some fancified lawyers setting up this scheme of LLCs just like surrounding these people to where any abuses at any particular place can never really be blamed upon the top brass, the head honchos, and by design. But yeah, I mean, I know what you mean. Like, I mean, I think the difference between like them naming names there and not naming the name of the, I almost would have to like go back to that part in the doc to see, to remember exactly. She explains the reasoning why they don't say the person's name, but that's because they're attributing like a very specific crime to that person. You know, you are a pedophile who is molesting girls at this place. Whereas with just saying like, hey, this fucking fat asshole at the top owns all these places. Like there's nothing illegal about, you know, saying that. Cause it's just a matter of
again,
fact, but
not yet. Not yet.
Yeah.
We'll get there though. You shouldn't be allowed to criticize millionaires. That's just me personally, I think.
For a second, I thought you were going like truth to power there. Like one of these days, it will be illegal for these assholes to own places like this. No, the other way. Got it. So this is the part that gets more confusing with lots of names, and maybe there's no point really, because
no, this is like the kind of like watch it for yourself if you really care. They'll break it down and tell you all the names.
Yeah, there were certain parts about, I mean, one of the more interesting things was when they got an interview with the son of one of these guys who absolutely like despises his father. And he's not even the top guy. He's like the brother of the top guy. That guy had like a fucking, he had a weird like villainous name.
Narvin?
Narvin, because it made me think of Curtis Yarvin. Narvin something, whatever their family name is. But basically all these people are like completely unqualified to do any of this shit. And there's a couple of they looked almost like legal proceedings like that were just being filmed, like depositions And the way these guys talk, like they just talk like such morons. And like it shows some of their like social media posts and stuff where they like they don't know how to spell. And like one of them was a guy like in like a brand new like fucking Lambo or something, I don't know, whatever, some fucking super expensive car, and just with like some fucking arm candy on his lap. And like the text beneath the picture was like, we go and kidnapping in luxury, like luxury spelled, kidnapping's misspelled, luxury's misspelled, referring to, you know, the quote unquote transportation services where you, yeah, put the black bag over the kid's head and bring him to one of these places. They also showed like footage of one of the many like palatial estates or whatever that the head of this, the WWASP owned. And I think one of the girls at the Ivy whatever academy some reason got to see this place while she was still an inmate, and like later like told her parents about it, and they were like, oh, like that's where our tens of hundreds of thousands of dollars went, to some fucking mega church preacher looking motherfucker. There's so much overlap with the I think maybe that's the other reason I found this documentary a little bit more, like, I don't know, compelling than maybe you did, is because like I also grew up with a preacher dad, and like some of these guys just remind me so much of that same like evangelical world, and for good reason, because a lot of them were that, like before they got into this business. At least the Narvin guy, he like considered himself like a biblical scholar or some shit. And who's the guy that they confronted? There's a guy who was like in charge of PR for this Ivy whatever school, Ivy Academy, Ivy something Academy, whatever, the main one in the doc. And so yeah, what they would do also is like some kids would have like one day, you know, one nice day out, and it was all just for photo op purposes. And oh shit, hang on one second.
For anyone not on this call right now, Josh just got that's not what happened. Josh actually just got a phone call from his doctor with results about his having gay AIDS. He got AIDS from, and he got it probably from being gay. Some people are saying maybe it was from sharing needles, but primarily it's from both. He was doing gay needle sharing on top of just that, and that's how he got the AIDS. And it's okay. We don't blame him for that or any of it, really. We think it's cool and good, but that is why he had to step away to get the results from his blood test that shows that he has gay AIDS.
Josh, I was wondering who you were talking about, because I came back in the last half of that. Yeah, I've got the gays.
It was tough. Some people call it grids, whatever. And I was telling the listeners that you had to answer the phone call because they said that you got it from sharing needles, but doing it in a gay way. So it was definitely, it was like still, you got both. You got it the bad way. You got the bad AIDS and you did it the bad way. Well, that's okay.
I gaily shot up into my ocular nerve. Yeah. Just like the kids at the program. I forget where I was. Well, okay. I mean, whatever. It's the thing that actually kind of brought down this particular branch, this Ivy Ridge Academy, had nothing to do with all of the actual like abuse. It was the fact that they were giving out high school diplomas that were completely fake. And they were definitely misled, and you know, the parents thought, oh, the kids are getting like a real degree, like a real diploma that they can use to like go on to college later. And then some of the kids didn't find out that this shit was fake until they like applied to colleges, and then had to be like, you know, kind of doubly humiliated by like, this isn't real. Like, so that was like kind of the beginning of the end of this place. But but all these places do that. And they have like these phony graduation ceremonies and everything. So that's another one of the ways that they would screw over, I guess, the kids and the parents alike. Oh, and they're like, the education itself was like a fucking joke, like at least at this place. And it seemed like this was common practice at all the places, though, was they didn't even really have teachers. They would just sit kids down in like a computer lab and have them do this like automated, like Bible based sort of education thing. I wish I had written down the name of the program because it looked so ridiculous. But yeah, that gets brought up in the documentary as well. And yeah, they would say they'd just like sit there basically kind of like dead eyed, like just staring at a screen, like kind of like hitting the enter key, like for hours at a time. And then they would bring up the fact again that like you could be punished if someone was catching you looking out the window, you know. So they like put a computer in front of a window and be like, you better not look out that window. Stick to your quote unquote studies.
So this is where we would do all our schoolwork. We'd spend most of our time just here in this lab. And couldn't look out the window. This is setting you up for failure right here. Computer facing the window. Not allowed to look out that. And they had this homeschooled program where we would do all of our work. We spent most of the day just sitting in here and like bullshitting schoolwork because we just had this homeschool program and no one would teach us. So we just keep taking the quizzes over and over again until we got 80 or above to pass. And that was like our high school. They would have like teachers, they would say, that would sit at the end there, that if we could raise our hand and ask them a question and we could get 5 minutes with them, and that would be our education.
I refused to refer to them as students because they weren't being given anything that could be called an adequate education. They were kept under oppressive conditions. You know, if you're going to market yourself as a school, then you better show me something that looks like education. And I'm sorry, I just wasn't seeing it.
Ivy Ridge's slogan was a boarding school for the future. Maybe they meant that at some point in the future it would be a school, because it never actually was one. It was a behavior modification program.
We use a level program that enables the kids to see where they've been misled and get rewarded for good behavior or consequented for bad behavior.
Jason Finlinson was the director of Ivy Ridge, and he's also an idiot.
Okay, so tonight we're going to talk about black holes. Black holes are, they're black because as they're condensed, they're really dense in the middle.
He couldn't spell or write a complete sentence to save his life. When a parent emailed him concerned about the quality of education at Ivy Ridge, he replied, "All of our teachers are New York State certified. All of the therapists are certified as well." I'm sure that response was reassuring. Jason had hired his little brother, Jake Finlinson, to be the head of academics at Ivy Ridge. But even Jake said, students are not here for academics, but to work on themselves and their families. Jake also banned several books.
Oh, I remember now what I was talking about before. It's technical difficulties. The guy who's like taking the photos and stuff and doing this fake PR shit. So they made like the Ivy Ridge Gazette, you know, and like would send out this stuff to the parents to update them or whatever. And it shows the kids like doing like horseback riding and swimming, going to the beach. And like they even put together like a fake like prom or whatever, which was like a total joke because normally, you know, the boys and girls are completely isolated from each other. But so this guy, this fucking lousy piece of shit, Tom something, they found out where he was in the documentary, and he shockingly had now taken up a job as like a pastor at an evangelical church. And I think before that he was some sort of local politician. So he's like the great trifecta of local politician, PR guy for a fucking abusive, troubled teen industry school, and now a preacher man. And they get like the audio of kind of confronting him in the church. And again, these people are just fucking shameless idiots. And she's not even like super confrontational with them. Like at first she's like, oh, do you recognize us? You know, we went to Ivy Ridge, and he goes, oh, no way. Like, like, oh, what a fun reunion we're having. Like kind of, you know, it, but obviously he like, he knows like he's guilty. Like this place is horrible. And anyway, he basically says like, oh, if this is going to be like some ridiculous 60 minutes style expose, I want nothing to do with this.
Yeah. Not interested in doing any of that Barbara Walters.
I'm not interested
stuff.
In doing anything that's going to make me look bad. And they and I think they at that point they just leave because they're like, whatever, this guy's a fucking moron. He's not going to like be candid with us. So, yeah, they just leave. And but they, I think later they come back to him and confront him about like, you know, some email documents they found of like emails he sent that were saying like he called MySpace like an evil website because it was allowing former students to meet up with each other after the fact, which was like highly discouraged. Like you were absolutely not allowed to give any contact information or even your full name to other kids because they don't want you fucking collaborating and like, you know, sharing notes later. Obviously, like these places have been sued like countless times by like individuals. It's just usually they just settle out of court or somehow it goes nowhere because of all of this you know, this protective layer of LLCs surrounding everybody. Or if anybody gets in trouble, it's like the lower level people. But like, you know, institutionally things always stay intact. But yeah, the guy called MySpace evil for the fact that like this was a way kids could communicate with each other afterwards. And he was basically saying in the email, like, I think we should like spy on these kids through the internet and like keep an eye on them and make sure they're not like, you know, saying anything bad about us. And they confront him with this email and he very pathetically says like, I have no idea what that is, like what that email is. And there's the other good scene that you kind of alluded to where the girl who, you know, they told her that her drug test lit up like a Christmas tree. And then they found like all she really wanted to find in the building was her drug test that would, and you know, and they did find it. And of course it said it was negative. So they, what did they do with that? They took it to the house of like one of the former employees, the one that like called her like a crack whore or something. And they just like, they put the copy of the test in their mailbox and maybe like described like, you know, you told me that my drug test was, you know, lit up like a Christmas tree, et cetera. And then so like later in the documentary that comes back, she gets a phone call while they're like, they're all like hanging out at a bowling alley. And
hi, this is Alexa. Who is this?
Did you see a paper in my mailbox?
I did.
I never said you were a crack whore. What's going on? I don't get it.
No, you didn't say that in particular. I was called that in seminars because you told my parents that I had been addicted to drugs and I found my drug test and it was negative.
I don't remember lying to your parents about that.
I remember.
Okay, so where are we going with this?
Well, actually, I was curious if you'd be willing to talk with me about some of the things that happened at Ivy Ridge.
What are we going to discuss? You know, the sad part of this is that you girls have had nothing but bad things to say about me, and out of anybody, I'll bet you I was one of the true people that really fucking loved you all and cared about what happened to you.
If you really want to help the girls, you'll help us now.
Why did you wait that many years then?
Because we finally have proof. We have the documents, we have the emails, we have security footage, we have everything.
I believe that, yeah, some of the shit they did was not nice.
Did you really believe in the program? Did you really believe that this was the best thing for kids?
To be honest, maybe I was a little brainwashed that this program was to be helpful and to work and to keep kids alive.
Would you talk to my parents?
And tell them what?
that the entire program was a lie, that they were duped, they were conned, they were lied to, that there were lies told about their daughter that has completely splintered their family, that you take accountability for your participation in that. That's what I want. Well, then you are not working your program if you're not taking accountability and you're playing the victim. And it's not about you as an individual. It's about you as part of an institution.
No, that's the problem right now, Lex. That's the whole fucking problem, because you're trying to make me be the only fucking person.
No, I am not. Believe you me. No, I am not. No, I am not. You are one of many people who contributed to a lifetime of trauma.
And?
That's the response? And?
I've got to go. I'm driving, and cars are passing me, and I guess, like,
sure is.
I thought that scene was pretty good, because it was, like, it was interesting to see these kids, like, I don't know, seeming to like be a lot more, I don't know, emotionally healthy now. You know, maybe they've gone through some like legitimate therapy, because like the way that they're like talking to this like former authority figure, I don't know, I thought it was pretty. And like they weren't being like snotty about it. They weren't like, oh, fuck you. It was just like, hey, you like played it, you. And I'm not blaming you as an individual. And anyway, the way that the person reacted was so childish and so whiny, and it was so it made me want to put the V up, the victim thing. Like they were just playing the victim. Like, I don't know. Maybe just watch a documentary. I'm not going to try to describe it. It's a pretty good part of the documentary.
Yeah. I think both of our general recommendation for this week is to watch the documentary. Even if I, like I said, was not the biggest fan of it, I still like think it's worth checking out.
I watched it twice, so like, yeah, I'm recommending it as well. I felt like I had all this like stuff to say, and it's just completely fucking fell out of my head. I feel like this happens every time on the fucking podcast. And the last one, why can't we pay a staff to fucking organize shit for us? That would be nice. Yeah, maybe we should just leave it there.
I think so. I think we did it. We've been recording long enough in general. I think we hit everything on this documentary.
There are two past episodes of this podcast that are sort of thematically related to the topic of this one that I would recommend checking out as well. Episode 60, which is about the rehab industry, like specifically the drug rehabilitation addiction specialist industry, which is very similarly cult-like and con filled to this troubled teen world. It's extremely similar, just with a slightly different demographic. And then episode 67 about the self-help in industry. I think those could be good supplemental episodes along with this one. And I do have, I mean, in addition to the default of I do recommend this documentary, the documentary got me in the mind of a couple other documentaries that I like. And I'll just quickly list them off here. I recommend Going Clear, Scientology and the Prison of Belief. It's a very, very good documentary about Scientology. I also recommend one called The Business of Recovery, which is talked about in that episode that I mentioned, episode 60. So that's about the business of recovery. It's kind of straightforward there in the title. And then when I was looking around for like, I think for like images that I might use for this episode, and I ran across one that it lined up with your recommendation in a way from last week of SpongeBob memes. But I found this picture on Reddit. It was like an AI image that someone had just, the AI prompt was like, SpongeBob attends Jesus camp. And it's this like horrifying image that I'll link to in the show notes of SpongeBob like screaming and crying along with a Very bunch of cool. screaming and crying, like hyper real looking kids in a church. So I'm recommending Jesus Camp. Did you ever see Jesus Camp? That was a big one back
yes,
in the day.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah.
That one again, like, got me a lot because, yeah, it sort of reminded me of my childhood in some ways. I did go literally to a Jesus camp. It wasn't quite as fucked up, I guess, as the one in the documentary, but yeah.
But it was almost there.
Similarly, as working in the troubled teen business was similar, but not quite as bad as documentary showed. But so yeah, Scientology doc, drug rehab doc, and Jesus camp doc. You put those on a Venn diagram and you kind of get this new documentary in a way. And do you want to rec anything beyond this?
No. WrestleMania weekend's coming up. That, I guess, it's gonna be bad, but you know, it'll be fun. Check out violentpeople.co for Quentin's article that just came up.
All right, cool.
That would be it.
When's WrestleMania?
It's probably like next Sunday, I think.
Sunday, April 7th, 2020, 8 a.m. Is that right? Okay. And yes, table setting, table unsetting, clearing the table. Well, of course, fuck Payoneer Global Incorporated, as always. Check out the episode description for all kinds of links to previous episodes of this podcast that I mentioned, links to documentaries and things in the general recs, and a link to our Discord. Please join our Discord. Please say some stuff on Discord. Engage. Also, if you don't feel like engaging on Discord, something I never remember to say here, but we do have an email address, which is the unwieldy heatdeathoftheuniversepodcast@gmail.com. And of course, we're also on Twitter. We're on other things too, but I don't really check them, such as Instagram. So I will say specifically don't message me on Instagram. But yeah, Twitter, email, Discord, those are the three good ways if you want to say something. And I will say that almost guaranteed that whatever you write, if you want it to be read on the show, it probably will be, depending. I mean, if it just said you died of gay AIDS, well, no, I'd probably read that too.
If it just said the N-word, I would probably say it.
I'll farm that out to Tim.
I'm allowed. People have told me that I'm a white boy with the sauce.
He's got the sauce pass, folks. Yeah. And as we always, often, frequently say, talk, enunciate in the troubled teen, at-risk youth, abduct-a-tot industry business field, brainwashing is good because it washes your damn brain. Scrub-a-dub yourself to OT level bazillion. Praise be to Xenu. The end.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. I'd never stay. I
The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Au Clair de la Lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it?